folks who are here to learn quite a bit today about municipal solar. We're really excited to have you here. My name is Carla Castillo. I'm a senior planner at the Hudson Valley Regional Council, and I direct the CDC program for the Mid-Hudson Valley, working with fellow coordinators Europa McGovern and Nicholas Moran. So I want to thank you so much for being here. We hope that you will walk away with a tremendous amount of useful information that can guide each of you in developing solar for your municipality. Before moving on to the main event, I wanted to touch on our organization a little bit. The Hudson Valley Regional Council is one of nine regional councils in New York State that are generally focused on different aspects of regional planning. In addition to our clean energy communities work, HVRC provides a snapshot of our region, region's economic status through the consolidated, the comprehensive economic development strategy report, which you can find on our website. We also assist municipalities with accessing funding for infrastructure projects, water quality planning and technical support, watershed planning, sustainability planning, solid waste and materials management issues, and data requests. So please feel free to reach out to us with any questions. As many of you may know, the Clean Energy Communities program was designed to promote the more efficient use of resources, help municipalities save taxpayer dollars, control the cost of government, create jobs, and drive economic development locally. The program is part of Governor Cuomo's aggressive energy strategy known as reforming the energy vision to build a clean, resilient, and affordable energy system for New York State by cutting pollution by 40% by 2030 and reducing total carbon emissions by 80% by 2050. To date, 50 municipalities have become designated clean energy communities in the state, with over 300 communities participating in the program, logging in over 400 approved actions across 70% of the state's population. So all of you are definitely having a big impact on the state. Europa will now give you a brief overview of the CEC program before we launch into today's feature presentation. Again, thank you so much for being here.
Introduction to the Clean Energy Communities Program. Like Carla said, I'm so excited to see such a wide range of municipal representatives today. Thank you all for coming. So basically, I'm also a Clean Energy Communities Coordinator at the Hudson Valley Regional Council. And we have been very busy being a boots on the ground presence in all seven of the counties in the Mid-Hudson region, and that's a 10 region statewide where this program, of course, is being implemented. Now, the Clean Energy Communities Program, it provides rewards and recognition to local governments that demonstrate clean energy leadership. And an important part of this program are the local coordinators like ourselves, which are available at every step of the way to provide some technical assistance to communities that are pursuing the program. And then the way the program works is that a community can complete 4 out of a list of 10 possible high-impact actions. Once they complete those 4 actions, they receive the New York State Clean Energy Community designation. Now, once they receive this designation, that gives them access to no local cost share grants, very popular, of course. And we have 18 available in the Mid-Hudson region, and they're up for $50,000 to $250,000. There's a list, which, you know, I have a beautiful slide with that list of the 10 actions, but honestly, I'm working with many municipalities, and I know Carla is as well, so I think everybody is familiar, at least with the actions that you're working on. And we have this lovely packet today, which I want to just give you a little review of. And so in the left-hand pocket of your packet, you'll see information on the Clean Energy Communities Program, and so that has your list of 10 high-impact actions. And then there's a beautiful PowerPoint presentation that delves into details on all of those actions. And on the right-hand pocket, let me just show you, we have here today's agenda. And on the fourth page, or fifth page actually, you'll see we have a nice blank sheet for notes. So as our speakers are presenting, please jot down any questions you may have, and then we'll be following the first couple of speakers with Q&A sessions, and then we'll have the speed dating, ever popular speed dating component at the end. Additionally, we have a survey that we'll ask you to fill out at the end, and we also have 100 Sprawls, their Clean Energy Upgrades Report, which is a chock full of information on all the good work that Wappinger Falls has done, and we also have information about local solarized campaigns. So without further ado, I will introduce our first speaker, who I have actually not met yet myself. There you are, Houtan. Let me just give you a brief bio here. So we're very honored to have Houtan Moavani, who serves the dual roles as Deputy Director of the New York Sun Initiative and as the New York State Distributed Generation Interconnection Ombudsman at NYSERDA. And Houtan is an accomplished energy and utilities professional with 10 plus years of experience in solar energy system design, analysis, and operation. He has successfully managed multi-million dollar solar programs, and we're very honored to have him here today. Thank you, Houtan.
Good morning, and thank you for allowing me to join you today for this great event. Before I begin, I want to give a great deal of thanks to Pat, Carla, Europa for they have done a tremendous amount of work to make this type of event happen. Thank you for the introduction. My name is Houtan Moavani. I'm currently serving as the Deputy Director of New York Sun, as well as one of the state distributed generation interconnection ombudsman. I'm delighted to be here on behalf of the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority. So I think we are just going through the slides together with Patrick. I think everyone here knows what's going on in New York, but just to provide some additional context, I'm going to lead off by setting the stage with a quick background about the New York Sun program, challenges it has faced over the course of the last couple of years, and what we have tried to remove these barriers and accelerate solar adoption in New York State. Next slide, please. New York has emerged as a national leader in the fight against climate change. The most important component of New York's renewable energy leadership is Governor Cuomo's Reforming the Energy Vision, or REV. REV seeks to fundamentally transform the state's electric system by making it cleaner, more affordable, and more resilient. The goal of REV is to change the regulatory and financial structure to build a 21st century grid. For too long, we have been reinvesting on an old central station-based production system, which is not the grid that we are supposed to have today. 21st century grid is hybrid, where we have both a central station production system as well as distributed generation resources, where electron flows in more than one direction and supply and demands are dynamic. Distributed generation resources are being treated more than just negative load. They are being treated as generation asset on both operation and planning side. And more importantly, REV is putting customer first by designing new initiatives to impact real people and provide individuals and communities an opportunity to play an active role to help the state achieve its goal. As a part of REV's strategy, state has set an aggressive requirement to have 50% of our electricity come from renewable energy sources by 2030. Next slide. Solar is a key component of Governor Cuomo's Reforming the Energy Vision. In 2014, Governor made a historic commitment of nearly $1 billion to stimulate the marketplace and build a self-sustaining solar industry in New York State. New York Sun aims to add 3 gigawatts of solar by 2023 in New York State. Over the course of the last couple of years, we have taken major steps to accomplish our goal. Can you please go to the next slide? As a first step, New York Sun program designed an incentive program known as the megawatt block to provide incentives on a first come first served basis until December 31st, 2023, or until funds are fully committed. The incentive program is based on a megawatt block design, as we have divided the state into three regions, Kacandes territory, Long Island, and upstate. Also, we have divided the system sizes into residential, like 0 to 25 kW, small commercial 25 to 200, and 200 kW, and larger all the way to 2 megawatt AC. Can you go to the next slide? The megawatt block, we have designed the program in a way that we have a targeted capacity and value set for each region. As you can see here, our incentive values, our successive blocks will have a diminishing incentive values. Can you go to the next slide, please? As you can see here, is like, I think this is like shows like a snapshot of our small commercial and residential dashboard. As you can see here, we have a value set and we have an actual block design. How the block works is really, really straightforward. It's like when we receive an application, that application is eligible to receive values set by the block at the time of their application submission. When a block is fully subscribed, that block closes and the next block opens. When all the blocks, as you can see, like all the way at the end of Long Island, our first segment of market that reached that self-sustaining industry, there will be no incentives available. Can you go to the next slide? This is like a snapshot of our commercial industrial dashboard. As you can see in rest of state, we are almost in block, actually almost end up the block 9, and in Kacandes territory, we are in block 2. Can you go to the next slide? Addressing soft costs is critical to New York Sun and for us to accomplish our goal. In addition to our megablock program, New York Sun has led several initiatives to make the process of solar installation in New York State faster, easier, and less expensive. Can you go to the next slide? I want to kind of go over our kind of two initiatives with the time that we have. First, I'm going to talk about interconnection, the kind of walk you through story that how we address and we move interconnection barriers in New York State, and then I'll talk about more specifically about our offering so far for our municipalities and what we're planning to do later. Next slide, please. Interconnection is an integral component of solar project feasibility from development timeline, certainty, and economic perspective. Interconnection in New York State became even a more important topic as we had larger system sizes and the higher volume of application coming in. In 2015, New York State solar market reached a scale at which interconnection was a bottleneck, dragging against market continued growth. Utilities face challenges to effectively manage interconnection application, particularly in light of 8-time increase in the number of application that they used to receive. Solar industry was sometimes struggling with technical spec of engineering studies, but more often with obtaining the needed information to drive their project to the most cost-effective location on the grid. We were facing with inconsistency in communication, timeline, project upgrade costs across different utilities. The interconnection queue, can you move to the next slide, please? The interconnection queue was the largest that New York had ever experienced. So the interconnection queue by the end of 2016 contained a large number of applications that had yet moved to the study process and were consequently delaying the progress for more recent application. To just put it in perspective, the queue had almost 4 gigawatts of proposed solar projects. This was like more than 11 times of the number of applications since beginning of 2015, and more than 4 times since beginning of 2016. We received our first community solar application in December 2015. By the end of 2016, we had over 2 gigawatts of proposed community solar application in the interconnection queue. Central Hudson, as one of the utilities, received over 700 megawatts of proposed solar application. When you look at it, that's like, okay, all those projects are connected. You're talking about 58% of the Central Hudson maximum load. So here was the situation under that we had. No one was happy. Not the utilities, not the solar industry. So under REV, next slide. Under REV, we created a space for solar industry and utilities to collaborate. When you look at it from big picture, both solar industry and utilities are working with a common purpose to drive distributed energy resources to the most cost-effective location on the grid. Of course, we understand utilities and solar industry are not going to agree on every point, but if we were able to stack out a lot of issues and find common ground, then we were down with much less issues. And for us as policymakers, it was much easier to understand what the trade-offs are. The art of good policy making is to get what you can get when you can get it, in the hope that over time you'll make progress toward a permanent solution. After months of work between my friends and colleagues from Department of Public Service, joint utilities, DG community, a significant revision to New York State interconnection requirement was released in March 2016, and it went into effect in April 2016. While the new SIR was a significant step forward, it did not rightfully address a large volume of application that had entered into the queue before the new SIR took effect. To remedy this situation, the Department of Public Service, in conjunction with NYSERDA, created two state ombudsman positions. I'm honored and privileged to be the NYSERDA ombudsman. My dear friend and colleague, Elizabeth Guzzaro from DPS, is the DPS ombudsman. Each utility is also appointed an ombudsperson of its own to help manage the connection application. The ombudsman team took several actions very quickly. The first one, can you go to the next slide? In order to increase transparency and establish common expectation, we released the queue information publicly for the first time. Stop the influx of application coming in and allow developers to site locations at the more cost-effective places on the grid, we created maps to show areas with DG constraint. These maps are not as comprehensive as hosting capacity maps, but at least it's showing areas that we can expect for interconnection costs to be significantly higher. After a lot of action, including this, we were able to clear a lot of inactive projects from the queue and a backlog of engineering study. To remedy the situation with the queue, can you go next slide, please? To remedy the situation with the interconnection queue, Department of Public Service created an interconnection policy working group to address various improvements to interconnection processes, including and starting with a queue management proposal. The policy working group is co-chaired by the state ombudsman. We have representatives from DG community, utilities, and large stakeholders like City of New York. The state ombudsman worked with the members of policy working group on a proposal to clear a backlog of inactive projects from the queue and allow well-developed, shovel-ready projects to move forward. The proposal recommended that the Public Service Commission modify its interconnection requirement by applying binding timeline and requiring certain project maturity for the application that had entered into the queue. Can you go to the next slide, please? And for the first time in New York, we came up with a mechanism to split this cost of certain upgrade among the developers and projects who are benefiting from it. In a parallel path, can you go to the next slide, please? In a parallel path, we work on it in a technical working group at the state level with solar industry, utilities, and a lot of interested parties. to address various technical issues with solar. Not going into details, and just considering the time constraint here, we focus on one of the more frequent and really expensive upgrade costs in New York. And after months of work, we came up with a more cost-effective upgrade solution for that case. So after all said and done, I'm honored and happy to report that New York interconnection cost is at an all-time low. After only a few months after the queue management order, we were able to remove 70 to 80% of inactive projects from the queue, and at the same time enable almost over 150 megawatts of community solar projects to pay for their upgrade and proceed. Next slide, please. That's like the first topic. Now I wanted to see like how, like, I mean, when you, if you would have talked to anyone in New York in 2015 and you would have asked what is the main challenge to solar adoption, probably you would have heard interconnection, interconnection, interconnection. The second really important topic, which is for us at New York Sun, we would like to work in a collaborative manner with a large group of stakeholders to maximize the value of solar PV. It's important for us to maintain a strong tie with our municipalities and find out what our local leaders are interested in and drive opportunities to deliver those desires. Give our municipalities what they want, not what we think they want. After being in this industry for almost 13, 14 years, I can say that municipalities are open to the idea of solar, but they need information and certainty. As you guys know, New York is a home rule state and we have 1,600 jurisdictions. Each jurisdiction has its own rules to zone and allow and manage construction. Some of our municipalities have been overwhelmed with the pace of solar development over the course of the last couple of years. To remedy this situation, New York Sun, in collaboration with our municipalities and with the industry, developed a guide for our local leaders to help make their decision related to solar adoption in their community. The guide provides authority having jurisdictions with information on permitting, zoning, decommissioning, property tax. We are planning to make this document a living document. We are planning at the latest improve and update this document on an annual basis. As I said, the latest, I hope we can do it more frequent. And I can discuss like what we have, what's our plan right now for the 2017 guide, what should be included in there, but we'll get to that later. From municipalities, there are enormous opportunities to go solar. So not only you can make your community solar friendly, but also you can go solar under a long-term contract known as power purchase agreement. These PPAs are win-win for municipalities for multiple reasons. First, you'll save money by potentially reducing your electricity bills. The added bonus is that because these contracts are owned and financed by a third party, you'll see immediate savings without making any upfront capital investment. Second, your project and municipalities will be able to monetize a full range of incentives available to solar right now. Under this contract, again, because it's owned and operated and financed by the private sector, this incentive like roughly represent 30 to 40% of the overall system cost. And finally, you know, you can protect your electricity price for the kind of, you can protect yourself against rising cost of electricity and have a guaranteed electricity price for next 20 to 25 years. Can you go to the next slide? But it's even more exciting when members of the community come together to support a clean energy project under community solar. Since July 2015, community solar made it possible for renters, for lower and moderate income households and others to participate, even if they cannot put solar on their rooftop. Residents who are participating in a community solar project, they are all local, all of whom are investing in their future and the future of state. They are saving money while they are making a significant contribution to the state's clean energy economy. At the same time, going solar for municipalities without necessary resources and expertise can be a daunting process. Generally speaking, there are three main challenges for municipalities to go solar: high transaction costs, steep learning curve, and fragmented regional demand. This process can be expensive, complex, and may require more time and energy than a single municipality can afford. Collaborative purchasing, CCAs, is one of the ways that you can address and remove these barriers. I think we have other panels that discuss like the CCAs and offering over there. At the same time, at the state level, we are trying to empower our local leaders by educating and providing resources on the nuts and bolts of solar development in their community. We are ready to provide you with tools, training, and expertise needed to bring solar to your community, to help you adapt to local municipalities. That's our number one priority in 2017, and I'm here to discuss further what we are planning to do at the end of 2017. How am I doing on time? Let's go to the next slide while we're deeper. As a central component of REV, New York is transitioning away from traditional net energy metering to a more precise approach to evaluate distributed energy resources. Traditional NEM credits project at the utility meter rate has been effective at growing solar industry in New York since 1997. I think we have someone else to discuss like the actual value of the order, but in a nutshell, I want to give you a quick overview of the value, the DDR order. Can you go to the next slide, please? New York State and Public Service Commission had in an order in February 2017 started this transition in two phases. So phase one is in effect since March 9th, 2017, until a permanent methodology is in effect by 2020. So, in a nutshell, can you go to the next slide, please? Very quickly, I'm going to go over how the new order would qualify. How would you qualify under the new order and your project? First, all the projects that already interconnected, already built by March 9th, 2017, they're all eligible to retain NEM for their lifetime of their system. So no action is required if your system is already built, already operational, already interconnected. Next one, please. We'll have a quiz at the end. For the new projects, for small commercial projects and residential projects, very, very straightforward. Your project would be eligible for phase one NEM. Phase one NEM is very, very similar like NEM. The only difference is the compensation term is not the lifetime of the system. It's just 20 years. So far you are with me, right? So the first one is your project is already connected. You will be eligible to retain NEM for the lifetime of your system. If it's a new project and it's a residential or small commercial project, you'll be eligible for phase one NEM, which is very similar like NEM, but it's a shorter compensation term. If you're talking about the larger commercial projects, like community solar projects, larger projects, like remote net metering projects or behind the meter installations, your project will be eligible to receive phase one NEM if you make your interconnection payment or sign an interconnection agreement by July 17th, 2017. There are some capacity limitations for community solar projects, but generally speaking, as long as you make your interconnection payment by July 17th, your project would be eligible to receive phase one NEM. Next slide, please. Projects that do not receive NEM or phase one NEM will receive value stack. Value stack consists of several elements. Some of those elements are time and location sensitive. So just going over the actual stack, we will have the avoided capacity, avoided energy, environmental value, and avoided distribution system cost. To ensure that community solar project and the industry continued growth as it transitioned away from NEM, community solar projects will receive an additional element known as market transition credit to align compensation with actual NEM. So again, one more time, you can see the value stack, avoided demand, environmental benefit, avoided capacity, avoided energy, and then market transition credit. Can you go next slide, please? Market transition credit gradually will decline in different utilities based on a predetermined capacity. Okay, so just to wrap up, can you go to the next slide, please? Just to wrap up, New York has structured this policy platform to be the best in terms of public-private partnership. This model under New York Sun is working. Can you go to the next slide, please? New York, as a result of New York Sun, since 2011, solar in New York State grew almost 800%. This includes projects of all sizes, from homes, small businesses, large factories, universities, and municipalities. We are here to push as hard as we can to make sure a great deal of work happens in our home state in New York. And we'll be creative and flexible and think out of the box in any way, shape, or form we can to encourage this. REV is complex, comprehensive, ambitious, and we cannot expect all the changes that we want on the REV to happen overnight. The collaborative process that I showed under interconnection and what we are planning to do, continue to do with our local municipalities, is the path for accelerating the pace of change on the REV. Now more than ever, we need to be united, and now more than ever, we need to build cross-sector collaboration to address various issues to clean energy adoption in our community. I've learned this, that in New York, that we don't have us against them mentality, which unfortunately these days is easy to subscribe to and is so prevalent. We first search for our similarities and build upon them rather than shining a spotlight on our differences. That's pretty much what I have for today. I don't know if we have any questions.
Sure.
Please.
Actually, Pat, could you go back to the value stack slide?
One more back.
Yeah. So Central Hudson, I was on a panel with someone from Central Hudson last week. And beforehand, we were talking about the value stack in Central Hudson territory. And there, Central Hudson is saying that there is no locational value anywhere in the entire service territory, which would really shorten that value stack relative to net metering. And I'm just wondering, like, how that, I know this is still under review, this is the tariff haven't been approved, but, how would this affect the economics for municipal projects?
So that is a very good question. First of all, utilities submitted their rates May 1st, 2017, and that's, I think, publicly available. You can definitely look at it, and you should encourage you to submit comments if you think it's not reasonable. It's kind of, at this point, it's too early to talk about exactly knowing if Central Hudson has any, they call like LSRV, meaning just essential strategic address for your project. It's too soon to say that, But hopefully we'll take it, yes. I mean, that's like, you know, we need to look at it and make sure something for sure. I don't think necessarily for behind the meter installation, the value would be below what you would have gotten normally under net. So we can discuss this, like how this would work. But I think in some cases, actually, especially if you are a demand customer, the compensation is even more attractive. Again, we can discuss that later as like how we used to before offer in KWH, PPA, and right now. Again, the idea here is to gradually decline the compensation, and we need to just be, I guess, like a very specific to your location and your, I think, time of use. Please.
You didn't mention anything about energy storage or battery storage, and I know in the New York Prize initiative was part of, that was a big part of integrating solar with battery storage. Where do you see that?
So yes, very good question. Thank you for bringing it up. NYSERDA is in the process of designing a new initiative for energy storage. Under New York Sun, we offer, if I'm not mistaken, $50,000 rebates for a storage project. But we are in the process of, as I said, like working with our colleagues from the Department of Public Service and utilities and other interested stakeholders for storage. I think, stay tight, I think it should come out fairly soon, hopefully by the end of this year.
New York arriving at a point where the state may say we cannot add any more solar projects to the grid? And will that, you know, will that differ by region, like Hawaii has reached, for example?
Yes, I mean, like we are not near the penetration level of solar or DG as Hawaii. And I think the idea here is what we are trying to accomplish under RABA that described, we are trying to build a 21st century grid. And with the 21st century grid mentality, I hope we will never ever get to that point that we can no longer do distributed energy resources. At the same time, I think as a power system electrical engineer, I have to say we need to consider while maintaining the reliability and safety of the grid, we should focus on where these distributed energy resources are most cost effective. So necessarily, I don't think like across the state, across everywhere, like this solution, these technologies would work. We need to find the right location for distributed energy resources. But I don't think we are not like anywhere close to that.
A number of the elected officials here have large-scale solar projects on the drawing boards. So now that there's all this change, how would you suggest they get, you know, some one-on-one assistance in?
Thank you. So we are, full disclosure, we are in the process of submitting an investment plan to increase the level of support that we can provide to our local officials. I'm currently working on two or three potential additions or chapters to be added to our local guidebook. I definitely encourage you to reach out to me directly. Under our current capacity, we have ways to support you, but hopefully as soon as our investment plan is reviewed and approved, we will have a better systematic way to offer support to our local municipalities. Currently what I'm working on, so if you have any comment, feedback, question, I'm working on the solar and property tax issues. That's essentially focusing on developing a toolkit, how to negotiate payment in lieu of tax. So we are putting together a resolution, a model agreement, as well as a calculator that you can enter the project specific information. And as a starting point, you can have a pilot amount that you can start the negotiation with, between your municipalities and a solar developer. We are working on a guide for Seeker to help our municipalities, hopefully by the end of this year. And finally, we should start collecting feedback fairly soon on another guide on solar on ag land. That's another piece of document that will be added to the already. I think we made sure that you have a copy of our solar guidebook. Please let me know. I'm here to receive feedback on the guidebook. I want to know if you think this is helping you. If not, like how we can improve the guidebook. Really, our plan is to make this guide a living document, improve it, update it every year, help you and provide assistance, expertise needed to implement and adopt this guide. It has a lot of kind of, not necessarily, when you say guide, it's not just here's an information. If you look at it, for example, on the Unified Soil Permit, we have a toolkit that you can look at the project specific, you can see what's required for permitting, what's required for inspection. It's really kind of detailed targeted for different segments of market. So, and here's my email address, and actually if you want, I can give you my card. Please reach out to me, as I said, I'm really, really curious to hear from you how we can improve the guide.
So thank you for having me. Great to be here, and thank you all for coming. My name is Miles Farmer. I work with NRDC. We are a large environmental organization based in New York. And as Europe mentioned, I focus specifically on energy regulation and work on a lot of different matters before the Public Service Commission and the New York Independent System Operator. NRDC participated in a long process that took place before we arrived at this value of distributed energy resources order. It was a collaborative negotiation, or however one would describe that, between groups like ours, solar developers, utilities, the Public Service Commission. And throughout that process, we were really pushing for New York to arrive at a solution that's going to allow for sustained growth of the solar sector. So, and thank you, Houtan, for that great lead-in. Some of my presentation may be a repeat, but I think a little bit of it's complicated enough that it might make sense to go through some of these things twice. And the basics, which I think he covered, are that the value of distributed energy resources order pushes for a transition from net metering, where a solar customer essentially has their meter run backward when their system is running as they inject energy onto the grid, to a new crediting system that credits projects based on the benefits that they provide to the system. And so the benefit of that transition is that it's sustainable in the long term. It provides incentives for projects to locate where they're most beneficial and rewards projects that perform better. But the downsides, or the challenges, are that it's a lot more complicated than net metering, as you'll see. And as a result, we have some concerns that it could be so complicated, or values could be so variable, that could make it challenging to finance projects. So that's really been a focus of NRDC's involvement here, is to try to work to a system that's simple, that allows for predictable values, that essentially allow the credits that New York is giving to solar projects to create the most projects possible. So first, what does this order apply to? For essentially, the big items for this first order are community and industrial projects, community projects and commercial and industrial projects. So these are kind of the mid-sized projects. Right now, that's up to 2 megawatts that are larger than your residential or small commercial rooftop projects, but smaller than utility scale projects. And for those projects, the order provided for a transition from phase one net metering, which is calling essentially any project that was built or interconnected prior to the March 9th order, to this new value of DER tariff. Now, for residential and small commercial projects, it provides for net metering to just switch to phase one net metering, which is essentially net metering with an explicit 20-year term. Those projects, if they want to, may opt into value of DER, but we're not really expecting that. And then for projects that are combined with storage, they fit into the tariff that's applicable based on their size. So a commercial or industrial project or community project that's paired with solar would get the value of DER tariff, whereas one that's a residential project paired with storage would still get net metering unless it opts in for the value of DER, and that's where it could make a little more sense because value of DER rewards performance. Standalone storage systems are not eligible for this initial value of DER tariff. That's something that is going to be addressed as part of the phase two process, which is essentially going to be the next iteration. And so this value of DER tariff is covering 2018 to 2020, at which point it will switch to phase two. We're expecting there could actually be several iterations. I, for one, would not predict that phase two is going to be the final outcome here. And we could also see kind of an iterative process where changes are made one by one, where, for example, as part of phase two, they might first allow for standalone storage systems prior to updating the whole value stack. So what is this value stack? It's your projects are getting paid based on the benefits they provide, which are energy, capacity, environmental benefits, distribution value, and that market transition credit that Houtan was talking about. And all of these benefits are just for injections into the system. So if you have a project that's located at a building that has a lot of load, when it backs down the building's load, that is not credited at this value stack. That just reduces the amount of electricity that that customer would pay for. And then this value stack compensation formula is the credits that are given for those grid injections. A really important point is that for those community projects where you have individual customers opting in to a share of that bigger project, they don't see this value stack. So, because one question we get a lot is how could an individual customer possibly understand what's going on here? And I think that's not really the idea or the way that the commission constructed this. The idea is that the project developer sees the value stack and then can offer that to the customer on whatever business model the project developer chooses. So for a community project, there is a subscription fee to opt in to the project, and the customer sees that fee and whatever value they're getting, and it's one of the items for the implementation plan is we'll see kind of what array of options the developer is allowed to provide, and I think we still have some concerns that this will all be complicated for customers or complicated for developers to translate to customers. But you know, you don't necessarily have to have every individual customer see this value stack, understand exactly how everything works, because some of that can be smoothed over in the subscription fee and the share and the interaction between those two. There are a bunch of different roles for how the credits works. Here are just a few of them. Customers can carry over their excess credits indefinitely, but have to forfeit them at the end of the 25-year period for which this value stack is applicable. The community project sponsors can use credits for a given year within a 3-year period and carry them over for any 2 years. Like I mentioned, the tariff applies for 25 years from the in-service date, which is different from the phase one net metering, which is 20 years. And one broader point I should emphasize as well is that right now, the stage of the process we're in, we have the framework for how the different values are going to be calculated, but we don't have the individual monetary values that will apply to each project, because that's, as I'll talk about, is being developed as part of the implementation process, which is ongoing now. So, let's see. For each of these values, it can get a little complicated how they're calculated. For capacity value, there are three different alternatives laid out in the order that a project can opt into getting. The first is that they would get the capacity portion of the supply charge for the service class with the load profile most similar to solar generation. So the idea here, and what capacity is generally, is a promise to deliver in those times when the system is most stressed. And so this is kind of a rough estimate approach that would credit a project just by looking at a load profile similar to that project and saying, okay, it'll probably be generating on a similar time scale as that, and so based on that we can figure out what percentage of the time that will coincide with system stresses and give it credit like that. There's a second alternative that a project can opt into, which is more performance oriented, which essentially takes that same total value, but then turns it into a kilowatt hour credit that applies based on the project's performance during the summer peak hours. So in that system, a project that really performs better during those summer peak hours would get more credit, and if it performs worse, it would get less credit. And then the third alternative is really tailored towards projects that are combined with storage, and it uses the same approach that NYSERDA uses for bigger projects, which is to look at the past year and look at that individual peak hour for the total system and then just measure how the project did in that hour. And that's the credit it gets for the next year. And so under that approach, you have to do an estimate for your first year, but then after that, the project is basically getting credit for how it performed the year prior. Distribution value. And I would say if there's one, NRDC's biggest concern with the whole value stack is the way that distribution value is calculated, which I think is pretty complicated and right now is hard to forecast, which could make it tough for projects to finance. So we're really looking as part of the implementation process for the commission to issue an order that provides for more certainty for those projects, whether by vintaging them and saying, if you're in at X time, we're fixing the distribution value for that project, or else doing something else that could at least allow projects to predict what distribution value they'll get. So the distribution value is broken into two components. There's a demand reduction, and then there's a locational system relief value. And the locational system relief value is only going to be available to some projects, and that's based on whether or not the project is located at a point in the system that is particularly constrained of that utility's distribution grid. And so on May 1st, all of the utilities put forth proposals for how they were going to divide up the value between the demand reduction and the locational value, and they assign proposed amounts of megawatts that would be eligible for each location based on their assessment of what the system needed in that, those locations, and there's currently a comment process on that. We're working with other solar advocacy organizations and environmental organizations to ensure that the way that the utilities proposals went forth, that they kind of capture all the value that the systems are providing, and we have some concerns for some of those utility proposals. And we're also looking for kind of a consistent process across the state, because to the degree to which it's more consistent, it'll be easier for everyone to follow. So these different values are based on utilities' marginal cost of service study. One of the challenges is that each utility has a different internal process for how they do that, but the marginal cost of service is essentially a formula that they've developed, that they've used, you know, since the beginning of when all of this is regulated, that's based on the cost of upgrading and maintaining their distribution and transmission system. And so the idea is that by having that cost, you'll figure out what the value of a solar project is that helps defer some of those distribution upgrades that the utility would otherwise have to carry out. And one of the challenges here is that this is the first time the utilities have ever developed their marginal cost of service on a basis that distinguishes among different locations on the system. Prior to this, they've always just had one value that says, okay, system-wide, this is our cost for, our cost of service, basically. And now they're all de-averaging. Different utilities are different degrees along that process. Central Hudson here is actually probably in the lead in terms of making its marginal cost of service study locational. So the way the credits work here, based on this distribution value, is that it looks like demand management programs, except there's a difference in, you know, I don't know if you all are familiar with those, but the program kind of takes that cost of service and then looks at the performance during those constrained times. And for the solar tariff here, it's based on the 10 peak hours for the distribution system. And for those locational values, that's going to be the specific locational peak within that narrow area. And this is the next, they've said that the DRV and LSRV, these two values, will be recalculated every 3 years when the utility develops its new marginal cost of service study. But if you're a project that gets the locational value, that locational value is fixed for a 10-year period. And so here's where our real concern is that right now, because the utilities could recalculate those values every 3 years when they update their marginal cost of service, there's not really certainty around how they're going to portion demand reduction versus the specific locations in the future. And how they apportion that could affect how your individual project is credited. So we're looking to have the commission put some boundaries around that, or else fix it for projects so that an individual project could predict exactly what it's going to get, or at least have some pretty good estimate of what it might get. And this is another important point. Not all projects are eligible for the demand reduction value. The demand reduction value only applies for the projects that don't get the transition credit. And so if you have a community project, and it's to the extent that they get the marginal transition credit, the market transition credit, and the commercial and industrial projects don't get a market transition credit, the market transition credit is for community projects. So that means that the commercial and industrial projects get the demand reduction, but community projects only get that credit to the extent that they have commercial and industrial customers, because a community project could either be 100% residential customers, in which case it will get the market transition credit for those customers, but not the demand reduction value. But a community project can have up to 40% commercial and industrial customers. And so if a given community project has kind of one big commercial off-taker, for example, that's 40% of the project, then it would get the demand reduction value for that 40%, and then for the remaining 60%, it would get the market transition credit. So, and this is how the market transition credit is calculated. This was like a spreadsheet provided in the order. Pretty complicated. It steps down, as Houtan explained, but initially, it's a specific credit for each utility service territory and for a particular customer class within that service territory. So each utility is ultimately going to have two credits, one for residential customers and one for small commercial customers. Question?
Would a school be considered a commercial customer?
Yeah, so right, the way that they divide between that is essentially the manner in which that building pays for electricity and the tariff class that it's in. So, and that depends on size, but it sounds like Jen knows the answer, and it's yes. Basically, if your building pays based on demand, the total kilowatt peak usage that the building uses, then that'll essentially put it into the commercial and industrial space. If you don't pay a demand charge, you're going to be in the smaller category and be getting credit. I think that's kind of the rule of thumb here. And so, again, there's one credit for small commercial, one credit for residential. It's specific to each utility service territory. And the way that the initial value was calculated is that they added up all the values from the value stack, and then they compared that to an estimate of the retail rate from net metering, and they valued the credit as a difference between the two, such that the total value of DER tariff would roughly approximate the credits from net metering for that first tranche of projects. And so that doesn't mean that the tariff is the same, though, because the tariff you're getting paid based on your energy value, capacity value, these are all more performance oriented, and it could really depend on how, you know, what exactly the energy prices are, what you know, what your project's performance is, more so than the net metering credits. But for that first tranche, it's designed to be roughly the same amount of total value. Then for tranche one, it steps down such that the credit only trues it up to 95%. And then tranche two is 90%. And so each utility has a specific number of megawatts that are available for each tranche here. And so for Central Hudson, I forget the exact numbers, but it's something in the range of like 40 megawatts for tranche one, and then 20 more for tranche two. And when a project, you get put into a tranche based on when you sign up. And so I think right now, Central Hudson, Tom was telling me, is about full in tranche one. So we're on to tranche two, which is now that 90% zone. And so, you know, in some ways that's a good sign. We've got enough projects signing up here that there'll be success, but that's if those projects that have signed up to get the credit actually ultimately get built. And so, you know, we really need to make sure that they can all get financing based on this tariff once the specific values are set up. And it also means that you know, there was this rush to sign up, so if you're still thinking about a project, you're getting less compensation than that initial phase, but you know, hopefully still enough to make it pencil out. So, sorry, I'm kind of going through there. The environmental value, I guess I should just say, also is based on the value of renewable energy credits. And that, there's an auction for those credits that NYSERDA conducts every year. And so a project will get the value based on the results of that auction. And so that it's kind of key to whatever the value is that the utility scale projects are getting for those renewable energy credits. And then energy values are based on the wholesale system values that NYISO has. And so now we're in this process of translating the framework for those values to specific numbers through the implementation process. And the utilities just filed their plans wherein they explained, you know, here's what they thought they should do for demand reduction, locational value, how they would calculate each of these different credit components. And there'll be some comments on that. And then we expect a commission order on all of this at the end of the summer. You know, if I had to predict, I'd say like September or late August of this year. And there's also an ongoing process where the commission staff are working with all of these various parties to kind of in tandem explore opportunities to create further soft cost reductions for projects. So that could be green bank financing for projects, consolidated billing. There is a proposal that they're working on to help encourage projects to serve low-income customers. A lot of different efforts to further bring costs down. And I should note also that a project is still eligible for New York Sun if it's getting this credit, so you can use them together. So it's also about how New York Sun is designed and how that works in tandem with the value of DER tariff. And then after all this, we're going to move on to phase two, which is, you know, further exploring this, further developing that value stack. And I'd say that there are some good things on the horizon for phase two and some other things that we're more concerned about. One of the good things is that we'll figure out a system for including standalone storage projects and other technologies so they can participate on a technology neutral basis. There's also going to be work on further developing these values and making them more accurate. So, for example, there's no value right now that they've calculated for the environmental value of peak reduction. So that's something they're going to work on. But then there are also things that are part of this process that I think are going to be pretty complicated and confusing. They're going to transition mass market customers onto something that looks like value of DER, and we'll see what that is. I would be really surprised if it's the same type of construct. It has to be something that's easier for an individual customer to understand. They're going to look at potentially grid access charges, non-bypassable fees, or other charges like that, which we find to be somewhat concerning. And then there are also, just a variety of other things they're exploring, like opt-in rate designs for individual participants. So maybe now I should just move on to questions. I know that's a lot.
It almost seems like you're not in favor of DER as you're presenting it. I mean, I just don't understand how, if you cannot monetize, if you cannot calculate the value.
Right.
And you're saying the projections for this, I mean, what did we do? Throw up our hands and say, net metering doesn't work, because it obviously works.
Right.
It's a question of who's profiting from it, right? And how, and is the real cost of distribution as it's presented, who's going to calculate those values?
Right.
That's going to be the authority that says it's worth X percentage of a penny or, 5 cents, 10 cents.
Right.
Is it a body that's going to come together that represents the consumer as well as, you know, the government? I mean, I'm missing something.
Yeah, so, I mean, I should say overall, high level, I agree with you on the effectiveness of net metering. I think it's a very simple, effective tariff. And so there definitely are some concerns with this transition to value of VER. At the same time, you know, in the long term, you can't have 100% of customers on net metering because then no one pays anything for electricity to upkeep the system. So the commission is engaged in something that's kind of looking at the long term, that is going to incent projects to locate where they're most needed. Eventually, this is going to be very helpful for projects that are combined with storage. We're seeing storage costs coming way down. So there are some benefits of this. I do think we're concerned that the tariff that has been developed is pretty complicated. At the same time, the commission is going to issue a final order at the end of the summer. So in terms of answering your question is kind of who's calculating this, ultimately it's that commission order that's going to set the rates for each utility service territory. And there is a pretty good process, I think, that they followed where the utilities put forth a proposal, everyone gets to look through it, you know, make sure that is capturing the value of the projects, and then the commission decides. You know, as part of that, I think many of these, so some of the components of the value stack are very predictable. The market transition credit is fixed. The environmental benefits, assuming they can work out some kinks around when the timing of when that credit is fixed, it's going to be fixed for the project, so that's really beneficial. So there are some components that are fixed that are actually more predictable than net metering, which depends on the retail rate, which could also vary. But you know, totally agree. There are some big concerns as we transition here, and some challenges.
Jen? Yeah. Just on the cost thing, and you know, 100% of it, you know, can't be on net metering. You know, we I can only speak to Central Hudson territory, but we pay, you know, among the highest fixed charges in the state. And those mm-hmm. fixed charges are the bulk of the delivery costs. And, you know, for an individual resident, the delivery charge, the distribution charge for in that volumetric charge is fairly small.
Right.
So it makes me think, you know, I don't really get that argument. So, I mean, it seems like
right. Yeah, and so I guess that kind of tees up this broader issue and to some extent what the commission was seeking to avoid. So what's been occurring in states across the country as solar penetration is increasing is you're seeing utilities come forth with proposals to really focus on raising those fixed charges. And their argument, which I agree with you, is at times, you know, not fully accurate, but is that they need those fixed charges as more customers enroll so as to prevent a cost shift to non-participants, and it essentially has escalated to a war in a lot of states where you have solar developers, groups like NRDC, putting out studies that show the benefits of solar and that really at the penetration levels we have, it's delivering as much a greater benefit than the cost, and so there's not a shift to non-participants. But it's, you know, in Nevada we had the commission issue an order that just discontinued net metering, and now there's a big swing back. And so I think by bringing everyone to the table to develop this tariff, the commission was seeking to avoid that sort of conflict and to get a process that would credit for the benefits provided so as to kind of prevent that sort of all-out war and potential, you know, utility proposals that'll curtail solar and et cetera. And so what we found is that that is a challenging process when you do that, and one of the difficulties is that it's very hard to calculate all of the different values that solar is providing. And so, you know, I think it was very important for the commission to include that market transition credit and to recognize that the credit approximated some of those values that were harder to develop, and then to commit to further develop the values in phase two. But, you know, I would have liked to see a portion of that credit be permanent and not phase out. So there was a lot of give and take as part of this process, but, you know, the alternative of going to battle with the utilities on fixed charges was not necessarily attractive either.
But long term, it just feels like you're taking a system that is established with net metering and is provable because meter didn't use
right.
that system based on the cost of utility that they're providing, and going to this much more complicated system that eventually will sunset. You know, 20 years isn't that long a time.
Right.
And it feels like what's the likelihood that in 20 years people are going to be seeing either an equal or a greater benefit of net metering in this new system? It just doesn't feel that way.
Right.
I mean, who's driving here?
Yeah, and so, I mean, I share some of these concerns. I definitely do. I think the benefit that the commission is trying to articulate around this is that when it sunsets after 2 years, we're going to move to something similar. And so by dealing with all of this now, we'll be able to transition in a smoother way than had the commission kind of kicked the can down the road and then eventually had some momentous shift. At the same time, you know, I think we have been urging the commission to go a bit slower, to start with something as simple as possible and transition step by step, because there is some challenge related to translating this all into financeable value stream. I think that we'll all be trying to explain the crediting our best so that projects can be successful. And I do think that they did enough to keep the industry going. And what's really important to us is that this whole process has occurred with the state's real commitment to furthering the solar market in the state, and that they're going to do things like additional soft cost reductions to help projects get across the finish line, and that they recognize that it's not as though they can just set up this value stack and go home and it'll all be solved. that won't be the case. Yeah, thank you all.
Thank you.
And feel free to my contact information is here, and I think they can probably share the presentation so that you'll have that. And don't hesitate to reach out. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Miles. That was really informative. I'm sure we could talk about just this topic all day. But we do have a jam-packed morning, so we'll move on to our next speaker. We're happy to have Tom Kacandes, who's president of Inside Track Solar Incorporated, which is a solar project development and technology company based in Red Hook, New York. Most recently, he led the development of the first community solar project in Central Hudson's territory and in all of downstate New York. And Tom has designed and sold dozens of commercial and residential solar installations in New York's Mid-Hudson Valley, and has served as a consultant to banks and financing groups to over $150 million worth of projects and project bids. So Tom, thank you for being here today.
Again, my name is Tom. Kacandes. I'm an environmental activist pretty much my entire life, but I'm also a private business because it allows me to be an actor in favor of the environment. I've also worked for New York State government for most of 20 years, and I'm an English major with an MBA who keeps ending up in construction and managing engineers, trying to get engineers to make sense. It's not as daunting as what Miles does, trying to get regulators to make sense. So, my purpose in being here is to answer your questions, full stop. And if you have a question for my talk and Jen's, just write them down and we'll deal with that in the what I'll call the question roundtable. I don't think I'm comfortable with speed dating as a term. That's just me. But anyhow, please write down your questions. And I'm going to describe some things that I'm more familiar with. And maybe in the course of that, that will answer some other questions in the course of that talk. So, how does community solar work? Well, as we were just speaking about, right now we have already passed, as of March 8th, a transition from where we had net metering for the life of your system to net metering for 20 years at the residential small commercial scale. Small commercial, again, being a non-demand meter ballpark, think of it as you're never turning on more than 10,000 watts at once and triggering that level where you get to be charged on a very different basis. And the bottom house is happens to be in Garrison, just south of here. That's me standing on that roof. I like building stuff. I don't like sliding off of 612 metal roofs. It wasn't a lot of fun, but it's a really beautiful project. And the other house is a friend of mine in New Paltz, where I've lived. And residential is the most distributed form of solar. We have a direct displacement of energy drawn from the grid. So I'm not really going to speak about much that's any different from what has been discussed so far, but I'm going to try to reframe that in the practical terms in which my little brain operates. When you talk about solar, one of the wonderful things about solar is that it is incredibly modular. The solar panels that are on the top picture, that LEED Platinum building that Rick Alfandre built in New Paltz, New York on 231 Main Street. I had the privilege of doing the solar on that. We put the four little solar panels down low. That was my idea because all the rest of the solar panels you didn't see. And he's a green architect, so you got to see that it's a solar building. But solar is wonderfully quiet, has no wastewater, water runoff impacts, and generally doesn't require a lot of maintenance if it's built correctly. These are important features of what Miles just described as the currently nebulous environmental impact. Generation at the source of use, displacing strain on the grid, and a most distributed at the point of use form of energy generation. Also happens to be silent, non-polluting, once you get past manufacturing, which I always like to keep track of. When you build it on a commercial or in a utility scale, you either have more inverters or larger inverters. The top example is more inverters. That happened to be a microinverter-based system that we built. And the bottom is a 2 megawatt almost system for which I represented the bank, but I have been better at President Container in Middletown, New York. Big inverter, the size of a small truck. As I mentioned, environmental impact is something I like to keep track of. The biggest joke to me is nuclear has zero carbon. Where did the carbon in mining
refining, transporting, building fuel rods, having 1,000 people drive to from security. Where did all that carbon go in the non-carbon nuclear? I don't know. But there is a certain amount of carbon, especially involved in making silicon. And what's happened in solar is we've used less and less silicon. Solar cells used to be slabs of glass. They were 400 microns thick. Now they're about 160. They're headed toward 30. A 30 micron silicon actually becomes flexible. I know this because I manufactured solar panels, which I'm mentioning only because it gave me some perspective on the arc of the industry. I traveled the world, Zurich, China, meeting with manufacturers of solar because I was selling solar technology for manufacturing the nifty rainbow colored panel that you see in the middle. But that is not what won in the market. What won in the market was global scale. We now have gigawatts, tens of gigawatts of solar production where we used to have 1 gigawatt, a fraction thereof. So I moved on to projects. Now that top left picture is me standing behind a little test array, but those similar solar panels I used in this project, those are, it's my styling sun outfit. It's good to be able to see where the other guy is on the roof, so lime green is popular, as you see in the picture in the bottom corner. That's our crew installing prism solar panels. These panels happen to be bifacial. We have an electrically active cell on both sides. We're using a white roof to reflect additional light onto the back of the array. Gives it some different generation characteristics, and in layman's terms, that system is kicking butt. It makes electricity when it's raining. It makes electricity almost when it's dark. Not a huge amount. And it does really well. Plus, it tells me what it's doing. But the point of those pictures is not for me to wedge in another selfie. I don't imagine that that picture is what I want to show anybody. It's just, you got to show up. Things move. They get built. When I speak about being an actor on behalf of the environment, I like getting things built that change the equation. So everything that I talk about is something getting built? Is it moving forward? Yes or no? Yes or no? I share a lot of Miles' concerns and even Houtan's concerns about how do we evolve this system so that we can sustainably and consistently get things built and make tangible progress, because in my personal opinion, we don't have a ton of time. Anyway, sometimes it involves being up on roofs, which is not actually my favorite thing, but you got to get where the sun is. This project, to put some specifics on it, is a moderate-sized commercial project that I converted into a community solar project because the project financials made more sense. It happens to be grandfathered under net metering, meaning that we get volumetric kilowatt hours for our generation applied to our 20 subscribers' bills. One of the main things that I want to communicate about community solar that most folks do not capture, and there is no rocket science in solar. The only difference between you and me is I spent more time thinking about it. You can understand everything there is to know about solar. I can even explain how photons turn into electricity, but you have no reason to have thought about that. I have. That's the only difference between us. In terms of community solar, if we built all of the phase one tranche of solar, which will have 40 megawatts approximately in Central Hudson territory, and I'll keep using Central Hudson because it's our local utility where this location is, also it's the one I'm most familiar with. If we build those 40 megawatts and we have the expected average number of subscribers, about 13,000 customers would move to getting presumably the majority of their electricity from a remote solar system. Great, that's progress. 40 megawatts, 13,000 subscribers. There are 300,000 customers in Central Hudson territory that include business customers. It's progress. We haven't changed the world.
let's keep track of reality. So when you build this, these are friends of mine that owned a medical office building. They needed a new roof anyway. We structured a very tax-efficient project so that they can have a roof that was part of the energy system by adding kilowatt hours to the output of the system. There was some tax benefit to that. The approximate cost of the solar was about $550,000 all in. We had to do some unexpected work because Central Hudson misdiagnosed what our interconnection would look like. And that system at 166 kW AC output, that's the output of the inverters, not the rating of the solar panels, will produce about 235,000 kilowatt hours a year. That's extraordinarily productive because we're maxing out those inverters most sunny days all day long. That's the bifacial aspect. Anyway, so solar panels, it's an inverter, it makes electricity. It's not any different from when I was on that residential roof down the road, except the billing side. So what is community solar? A single array, usually a big one. The output of the solar kilowatt hours goes directly to the grid. It goes to a meter called a host meter that is dedicated to that array. So I have a meter, I get a bill. It says, surprise, you owe us $35 as a basic service connection, and this month you produced, April we produced 23,000 kilowatt hours. My house in Red Hook, New York, on the other side of the river, is not getting those electrons per se. Forget that. It's an economic association. My entire bill is offset by the kilowatt hours produced remotely by this big array. So that's basic structure of community solar. I'm not really telling you much, but I'm asking you to think about it a little differently. What are the real implications of building community solar? Should your community be involved, or should you merely cheer, or what? We'll get to that. So, the utility then is handling a crediting mechanism. And frankly, the early chat among developers is that some utilities are doing better than others. I was the guinea pig with Central Hudson. I fully expected that we would have some hiccups. In reality, every single bill we got from them for 6 months was wrong. And I complained about it vociferously, and I ended up going to the state of New York to complain about it. And then the next day, all of my bills were fixed. So sometimes it involves work. How does it work? Work makes it work. The utility takes the host meter, say 100,000 kilowatt hours, and divides it by a percentage. Tom gets 2%, Bill gets 4%, whatever. And then those credits are supposed to show up on the individual bills. And here's something you haven't thought about that I have. There is a time lag. When you develop community solar, timing becomes very important, except the utility controls all the timing. I, for example, mailed an allocation Friday not long ago, and I have no idea when that allocation is going to be applied. When are my new customers going to come on board? What do I tell those people? I have no idea, because the utility is doing that. I get to file a piece of paperwork according to the regs, and I don't get any feedback from the utility about when that is happening so I can correctly shape the expectations of my subscribers. That's a real issue that you deal with when you are managing a community solar project. And it's a big deal. Hey, Jen, my credits didn't show up. What's going on? Those communists at Central Hudson. It's just, it's a billing process. I don't know. It's a billing process. Miles said something important that I'm going to underline again. Consolidated billing. Right now, when I charge for my kilowatt hour credits, that is separate, a separate bill from Central Hudson. They don't want to know anything about what I charge. They don't want to hear anything about my kilowatt hour credits. That's sort of the deal. the idea is that we are not regulated as an energy services company would be regulated. There's some regulatory logic to that. But the disadvantage is I'm doing separate billing. That means that I need to collect that money for the project to repay its financing. And that becomes a big deal. It's one of the biggest barriers to participation by the low moderate income community. So charging for credits, and you see, I tried to translate this into a little conversation. Hi, here's your bill for $100,000 worth of solar credits. Please pay us $90. My project will probably be the only project on a legacy basis where kilowatt hours show up on my bill in red. If your community solar subscription, what will happen is you will functionally buy $100 worth of credits to show up on your bill for a discount. It's going to be a very simple transaction. Unfortunately, that's not what people want to buy. What people want is they want to get off the grid. They want to take an effigy of Central Hudson and light it on fire. That's what they really want. When you really talk to people, they say, I want to kill that piñata that has Central Hudson name tag. My name is John from Central Hudson. I want to kill it. It's a very interesting dynamic. Like, well, dude, calm down. Anyhow, so we're not really giving customers what they want. What they want is to wipe out their bill. Well, there's always going to be the basic service charge. And I would submit that in the regulatory conversation, utilities have already won the fixed charge battle. $24 a month to send a bill? Oh my God. That is, sorry, God. We're in the church. I shouldn't be prepared. Anyhow, it's a lot of money. We're already paying some of the highest fixed charges any place. Oh, and Central Hudson's even more than Con Ed. Oh, thank you. Anyhow, so it's simple, right? What could go wrong? Well, this is a recent reconciliation. All of the bills of my community solar project are being calculated by hand. They were all calculated wrong. I think I mentioned that. And then this bill, the person said, so they charged me $685, and then they credited me $644, and then they gave me another credit of $939, and then there was a credit of $4166, and they turned around and said, so is this right? I have no idea. So here's the deal. The utility is the one, they have to be the ones to read the meter and transport the credits. That's basic arrangement. But I end up explaining their billing. They don't want to know anything about my billing, they don't want to collect money for me. I spend a lot of time explaining their billing. And again, if we're going to execute on the reality, if we're going to realize the progress and be the environmental actors that we all intend to be, we need to figure out how to execute on this reality and explain it to people. And that is not a small thing. It's big. Okay, I think you get the point. So making it work takes a lot of work. You've got to find the subscribers. I'm now presuming you want to do community solar. I'm not really trying to talk you out of it. It might sound like that. I'm just explaining what you need to do. Okay, so making it work takes a lot of work. You need to have somebody who is prepared to do the work. And presumably they're going to get paid to do that work. So that is a cost to your project. Finding subscribers, explaining what the community solar is and is not. No, we're not going to burn or kill any Central Hudson employees. You will just get a credit on your bill. I really want to kill them. No, you're just going to get a credit. Great, okay. It's a whole conversation. Answer their questions, answer some more questions. Then you need to have a contract before any benefit has happened. So you need to get people to sign a contract. That's not nothing. You need to make sure that you have correctly set their expectations, like Central Hudson still provides you electricity, don't cut any wires, things like that. You need to organize the bill information, figure out how much electricity each account uses. Now do that 350 times. It's not nothing. then the allocation to people needs to both meet their expectations and correspond with a meaningful amount of your output. And one of the things that I would do immediately and will do on my next array, if you use a tiny amount of electricity, guess what? I will not deal with you. I don't have time. It's not worth it. I have the same cost to deal with each customer. I will not deal with tiny customers ever again. If you are a risk relative to paying your bill, I will not deal with you. I can't make environmental progress if I'm wasting time dealing with people who don't pay bills. Let's be real. I also don't have money to loan you. I don't have free credits to send you. So I'm probably going to have you pay me before your credits show up. That reduces the group of people who are willing to participate. But it's a necessary feature of how I need to operate. So finally, you need to audit the utility and collect the money. So these are the tasks that are unavoidable. If you want to do community solar, you need a site, you need to organize it, you need to do interconnection, as Houtan explained. Interconnection is a big deal. And you need to, as a municipality, answer a question that I didn't have to answer as a private actor. Who is allowed to benefit from your project? If your project is using public land, and I'm a resident of that community, why are they able to subscribe and I'm not? So I'm largely out of time, but when you think about putting together a project, you need to emulate what I did for my project. You need someone who will do all the work, someone who will own the asset, and someone who will finance that project. And then you need somebody to build it and organize it. So I'm going to hit escape. Did that get rid of it?
Yes.
No? It just makes it look ugly. Sorry. Anyway, thanks very much for your time.
Thank you, Tom, for that very entertaining presentation, as well as informative. So we're having one more very knowledgeable speaker, and then we'll have a break. And we do have some water out here, in case anybody's parched. And then we'll move into the speed dating after that break. So one more exciting talk, and that will be Jen Metzger. She's a PhD and a director of Citizens for Local Power, which is a community-based organization working to create local clean a local clean energy economy in the Mid-Hudson region. And she's been an active party on behalf of CLP to the New York State Public Service Commission proceedings on electricity policy and regulation, including reforming the energy vision proceedings. And Jen is also a Rosendale Town Councilwoman and is Citizens for Local Power's representative in the Mid-Hudson Streetlights Consortium, which she co-leads. Thank you, Jen.
Are you all still awake? They were actually exciting, but really, some of them very technical presentations. And so I hope I don't lose you too, but we can always get some questions when we do the, what did you call it, Tom? I'm not comfortable. My husband's not comfortable speed dating. So, okay. So I call this presentation Community Choice Aggregation, A Path to Local Power. Power in two senses of the word, of empowering our communities over energy decisions, which we believe is really important, and of course, getting your power, where it comes from. I've been assigned to talk about CCA and solar. But I want to first just go over the kind of nuts and bolts of CCA, and also give a shout out. I'm in the town of Cold Spring, which has adopted a local law to enable CCA, I understand. And there are a few communities down here, or in the general area, Fishkill, right? Phillipsburg.
Phillipstown, sorry.
And Beacon, which is really great. So CCA, just in its most basic form, municipalities or groups of municipalities can pool the buying power of their residents and businesses to one, secure alternative energy supply contracts. That's an alternative to the utility supply contracts. And secondly, to develop energy programs tailored to community needs and goals. You can think about a CCA as replacing your utility as the default supply of electricity. Did you choose Central Hudson? No. So essentially, when you start a CCA, those residents and businesses, and I got to qualify this in a moment, that got their supply from Central Hudson will now be enrolled in the CCA, but they can opt out. And in the New York State, in the Public Service Commission order on CCA, there are pretty detailed procedures of notification so that people know what's going on and can choose to go back to the utility if they want, or choose an energy retail supplier of their choice. If people have already made the active decision to sign up with an ESCO, retail energy supplier, then they would have to opt in to the CCA. In New York State, which is different from some other places, the large customers, the ones with demand meters that we've talked about earlier, are not participating on an opt-out basis. They would have to opt in. The reality of New York State is that 75% of residential, small, or commercial, mass market customers, as they're called, are still with the utility, but it's the opposite with the large customers. 75% of them are pretty much signed up with ESCOs. So just in terms of the division of labor, it's important to keep in mind that the utility is still responsible for delivery. They still own the poles and wires. They still do the billing, although it is possible to take over that billing function if you really wanted to. Also, when we think about municipal programs, we think taxes, that's how they're typically funded, but with a CCA, the administrative costs are recovered through the rates, the electricity rates, and not the taxes. So I want to just give a kind of brief overview of CCA and its evolution as a concept, as a construct, because it has changed a lot from when it was first invented. It was invented in the 1990s. There was deregulation of supply. The utilities were forced to sell off their generation, and the idea was competition would be created in retail supply markets, and this would benefit the consumers who would get cheaper supply, and that didn't happen. Best laid plans. The small customers are not really worth competing over like the Walmarts of the world are. So CCA was really invented as a public service where municipalities could aggregate the load of their residents and businesses and leverage that buying power, typically to get maybe a reduced cost or more stable rates over a fixed term, sometimes 2 to 3 years. As time went on, our communities became more and more concerned about climate and wanted to procure cleaner energy. So CCA was used, that leverage was used to procure also greener contracts, and people, communities were interested in, for instance, 100% renewables, but this was still through the retail supply market, it was through the purchase of renewable energy credits, so you could be supporting wind farms in Texas, which is great, but it's not local, and not necessarily adding generation to the grid. So this decade, the CCA evolved further, and the CCAs, these are really the CCAs out of California that have emerged, are really taking it one step further and focusing on local clean energy investments. So why do we care about that? Well, the environmental benefits, of course, clean energy, we all know, but there are also really big economic benefits. If you think about it, in New York, York, most of our energy dollars leave the state. Most of the money we spend on energy leaves the state. So try to imagine now that a sizable portion of that money stays in your community. It's invested in your community. It makes a big difference. Clean energy industries are more labor intensive than fossil fuel industries. They create many more jobs. For every 1 million invested, 17 jobs are created in energy efficiency, 14 in solar compared to just 5 in natural gas. Also, of course, if you're investing in energy or encouraging investment in energy efficiency and renewable energy in your community, you're reducing the cost of doing business, you're reducing the cost of living for your residents, freeing up more money to be spent in the local economy. I just want to point out too, this is a bar chart from the Department of Energy, National Renewable Energy Lab, just illustrating the benefits of local ownership of renewables. There can be a sizable difference between local ownership and absentee ownership, either the utility or a developer from far away. When it's locally owned, more of that money stays local and more local jobs are created. And finally, of course, I just want to point out that it's sort of inherent to fossil fuel prices. Their volatility is just an inherent characteristic of it. In New York State, natural gas, dependence on natural gas to generate electricity has grown enormously, 100% or so, the last decade. And so we're at a place now where electricity and natural gas prices go in lockstep. And renewable energy, as Tom explained all the benefits of, you know, it's the ongoing, the costs are upfront in the capital investment. The fuel is free, the maintenance is fairly low. You'll know what you're paying for energy 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years into the future, which is very helpful for businesses. It's very helpful for families just trying to budget. So I want to just give you a flavor for the diversity of CCAs and how they're organized in different places, because how you organize your CCA is going to influence the kinds of programs that you can develop and offer. You know, a very common one is just your sort of basic model, and that's the model that I guess of the old school version when CCA was first started. You're focusing just on basically on bulk procurement, on contracts with an ESCO. Communities often will hire a CCA, a consultant to be their CCA administrator and sort of do the heavy lifting for them, negotiate the contracts. This model has not really been used to deliver other types of services. For instance, local solar, it doesn't mean it's impossible, but it just hasn't been used to do it that way. The CCAs that have done more local programming tend to have their own local institutional capacity to administer those programs. So the Cape Light Compact is the oldest CCA in the country. It was formed in 1997. CCA started in Massachusetts. It's 21 towns, 2 counties, and they formed their CCA through an intermunicipal agreement and created a governance structure. All the municipalities, they have a somewhat complicated voting system, but all the municipalities vote and collectively make decisions regarding policies and programs. The actual administration of it, they've entered into an administrative services agreement with Barnstable County, and they have like a dozen employees administering their CCA programs. But they're all, their salaries are funded by the rates, so they're completely independent of the county and the vagaries of county politics. but they are taking advantage of those back office efficiencies. And that CCA has focused really on energy efficiency programs because that's what its residents and businesses really wanted. But they did set up an electric cooperative, and because the municipal members were really interested in building out solar. And essentially what they did is like a mega aggregation of municipal projects, and they installed 28 megawatts of solar through this, and you know, because of the size of the aggregation, got really good terms for their PPAs. And unfortunately, I didn't bring those with me, but there were no escalator costs, and they were very happy with. And this is the kind of thing you can do if you have this level of intermunicipal cooperation. Another model is a public authority. This is what they do out in California. And the difference with an authority is that, of course, you can own property and you can issue revenue bonds. So that opens up the potential down the road to invest in local renewable power directly for your customers. So let's talk about Q-Play. So I'll just give you a couple of examples of, so Marin Clean Energy and Sonoma Clean Power are the two, I guess, longest standing CCAs in California. They offer, this is Marin's rates, three different rates, light green, deep green, and a local green rate. And they've been able, even in both cases, their rates, even their basic rate is well below the utility rate, but with a higher, much higher level of renewable content. The local, their rate to support local projects is like a premium rate that customers can opt into. But it's great that they're supporting that local development. That's just more. So in addition to just procuring power directly as part of their supply contracts from local renewable sources through PPAs, as part of their supply mix, they have other programs to support local renewable development. They have a feed-in tariff program for projects of up to 1 megawatt. Essentially, the CCA purchases the power above market rates to support that local development. They have enhanced net metering incentives for their customers, so they pay residents and businesses a penny more per kilowatt hour than the utility does to encourage, again, behind-the-meter investments in their communities. They also have shared solar programs. They have a lot of multifamily housing out there. That's always been a tough nut to crack to get solar on multifamily housing because of all the meters. So we now have shared solar here, so we've overcome that. And by the way, they finance. How do they finance all of these programs, you might ask? They basically finance it through a portion of the savings, that's basically the difference between the rates that they charge and the rates that the utility charges. They return a portion of that savings to the customers, and then they retain a portion to finance the programs for their customers, for their businesses and residents. So what about New York? Last year, New York became the seventh state to enable CCA. It was enabled as part of the Reforming the Energy Vision initiative, which, as was mentioned, is really changing the state regulatory framework to support a shift from that, you know, large-scale, long-distance transmission system of power generation and transmission to a more distributed energy system that relies more on distributed energy resources, not just renewable energy, but energy efficiency, demand response, at the point of use, so you know, on our churches, our schools, our homes, our businesses, our farms, the like. And CCA, community solar, these were both initiatives that have come out of the REV, are seen as supportive of those goals. In New York, the CCA regulatory framework, the Public Service Commission, was very kind of self-conscious in not saying, well, we really don't have much experience with CCA, and so that the order contains things where they say you can't do this, they're like, well, not at this time, you can't do this. And essentially the framework is fairly flexible. If you are going to establish a CCA, you have to submit an implementation plan to the Public Service Commission, which is actually better than just submitting it to Department of Public Service staff, because you can, and they're encouraging them, proposing pilots, coming up with new ideas, and communities are really encouraged to get creative. And even if something is not explicitly permitted in the order, you should think about proposing it anyway, because there is a desire to see CCAs succeed in New York State. One difference I want to point out, because there's been a lot of confusion over this. So CCAs in New York State, unlike in California, they're not considered what's called, it's a horrible regulatory speak, but load-serving entities. And basically, they cannot, CCAs cannot directly, you know, procure power from a from generators and then, you know, sell it to their customers. They have to go through an ESCO, through a retail energy supplier, so they have to negotiate contracts rather than procuring the power directly themselves. So they can't enter into a into a PPA and then sell that power. Unless, and actually I just had a conversation with some DPS staff about this, unless the CCA itself becomes an ESCO. So this is something that we're sort of exploring with staff, or plan to explore with the Public Service Commission, this idea of basically CCAs becoming public ESCOs, because, you know, eventually, you know, we would like to see them investing directly and supporting directly renewable generation. But as it stands now, unless you do that, you may be able to require some local procurement as part of your ESCO contract. And I think that sustainable Westchester contract, Westchester Power contract, included that in their ESCO contract. It's a little tricky because typically producers want 20-year contracts, and an ESCO contract is like, you know, a supply contract is maybe 2 and 3 years. So I'm not quite sure how that's going to work. But there is a lot else you can do as a CCA in New York in terms of helping build out or facilitate the build out of local renewable energy in your community. And one thing we say that is really missing that is extremely important is doing the energy mapping and planning. And the CCA, you know, ultimately your goal is to reduce over time the amount of energy you're procuring from elsewhere by reducing the amount that's used locally and generating more of that energy locally. But to get there, you kind of have to know what your potential is. You know, like how much can we develop in our territory? So we would really love to see the mapping and planning be a centerpiece to CCA development, mapping. It's how many communities here have done natural resource inventories? Have any of you done that? So it's kind of like that, but for energy potential. And as part of the REV, the utilities are making grid data available, system data available. We'd like to see that made available in GIS, but essentially, you know, you can overlay system data on your own mapping, and you can start to identify the cost-effective opportunities for investments in renewable energy and other distributed energy resources, and then develop programs and services to facilitate that. And you know, these programs could be, you know, aggregated procurement of customer-sited solar. How many of you have heard of Solarize? So almost everyone. Okay, so this is like giant scale Solarize program. You can facilitate community solar development, and you have direct access to this whole, you know, the entire customer base, and can for those, you know, residents and businesses that cannot site solar on their renewable energy on their properties for whatever reason, they rent or they just are poorly sited for it, you know, you can identify where that potential is and start making up for that difference with community solar projects and really localize as much as possible and reduce our dependence on energy and long distance transmission as much as possible. And I just want to mention that right now there's a state-level working group. It's headed up by Brad Tito, who is the program manager for municipalities and community energy programs? And local government. Okay. And it's a working group of the Clean Energy Advisory Council, which is Public Service Commission, DPS staff, NYSERDA, the utilities. But anyway, this working group is focused specifically on CCA. I'm in it, a couple of people in the back of the room back there in it, Glenn and Mike Rausch. And it's got a lot of really great minds kind of working on looking at what are the possibilities for additional financing and programs to support CCA, local CCA programming here. So I think that there are going to be a lot of opportunities coming down the pike. I just want to briefly point out there are huge advantages to establishing a local energy program and really creating that local institutional capacity and energy that we need. We have local knowledge in our communities about potential sites, about who the customers are. We know where the multifamily housing is. And you know, you can identify those opportunities and, like, you know, aggregate a bunch of, you know, solar projects on multifamily, I'm just giving an example, multifamily residences. And you know who the businesses are that might want to host a community solar project, or it's much easier if it's easier, you're in a position where you can find that out. And you can make connections with your local contractors, your local businesses, and your communities that are in the clean energy industry. Plus we all have, you can enlist local partners, you can enlist schools, you can enlist community colleges in your programming. Okay, I'm almost done. So there's just a lot of potential there. If left just to the market, we're not going to probably get as far as we would like to get and what the potential is than if we really focus this as a community and move forward. And I just want to mention, finally, one other point. You can really also efficiently harness federal and state funding too for to support local programming. I've got examples of that I can talk about later, because we don't have enough time right now. I just want to mention we are right in Ulster County, which is where we're based. We've been facilitating a working group on CCA since last July. It's been about six municipalities actively participating in it on a monthly basis, and other organizations working in the energy space. And we're looking at creating a local energy development corporation as an LDC as the administrative structure for our CCA. And you really have to think long term and where we're going, because there are going to be a lot of opportunities emerging over time in renewable energy, and you want to position your communities to take advantage of them. So I'll stop there.
Jen, and thanks to all this morning's speakers, Miles, Houtan, Tom, of course, everybody was provided a wealth of knowledge, I think. We covered a broad array of topics. We'll move into a break now, about a 10-minute break, and then we'll do the speed dating, or as we called it, the round tables. We'll tell you all about that. Thanks, everyone.
Is there any way that we can have a better reason or the heck have you done sort of on that?